Hi, everyone, and welcome to another episode of She Plays Games. It's crazy to be at episode 14, and I'm so thankful about how supportive everyone has been. This week, I'm really excited to be talking with Frankie Ward, who's a freelance presenter working in gaming and esports. Frankie has really had an intense road leading up to her current position, and in this episode, we discuss what it takes to succeed in her role, how to battle negativity, and how to best prepare for the different aspects of the job. This is episode 14 of She Plays Games. Welcome to the show, Frankie. It's so great to have you on. And can I just say how in awe I am of what you do? It just must be so nerve-wracking.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
How did you realize you had like a talent for speaking in front of hundreds of thousands of people?
Well, I think when I was younger, I was good at public speaking, you know, when I was at school and stuff, because my school let me feel like I could do all that stuff. And then I don't know, a few jobs made me feel like I couldn't and that no one wanted to listen to me. And then, I kind of rediscovered that I could. And when I'm hosting, for the most part, I'm doing interviews and stuff. So I don't think about loads and loads of people watching. Mm-hmm. And then when I'm on stage, although, yeah, I'm talking to people at home, I never, ever think about audience numbers. I'm always just thinking about the people in that room and how they're feeling. So that could be one person doing a sideline interview with me, how they're feeling, trying to make them feel comfortable while also trying to get them to give me the, you know, give me some information, answer my questions. And then if I'm in an arena with loads of people, that's something where I've had to get comfortable being myself again, because for a while last year I felt like I shouldn't be myself. And now I've got to a point, especially with doing Call of Duty London at the start of this year, I've gone, oh no, actually, no, people like me for me, so I should never try to be someone else. But yeah, so I think really it's about a relationship with the camera and a relationship with people in the room. And when I'm on stage, I am a voice for those people. Like, I'm there for the same reason they are, because I love esports, and I love, especially with Counter-Strike, of course, I love those teams and I love the game.
Mm, absolutely. I mean, like, do you take part in a lot of community stuff then as well to just sort of gauge how everybody's feeling?
Well, it's more that I will go out and I'll actually go into the audience and I'll speak to people in person rather than via microphone as well. So I like to try and meet people. It varies from place to place. Like with Counter-Strike, people know who I am, so I can just go and chat to people. Like Astralis, who are the number one team in the world, did a thing at Currys BC World on Tottenham Court Road in London the other day. So I went down to do some interviews and I just went outside and kind of met everyone in the queue just to have a chat to them, because it's really fun to talk to them about their teams. I do go on Reddit, but it depends, because I think mostly I communicate with people through Twitter. I find that sometimes with forums and things like that, there's a mixture of posts, so it's not always the healthiest place to go depending on what's going on. So if I'm doing an event, it's really tempting to go to Reddit, but it's not always the best place to be, because people are having opinions. And when I first started out, those opinions weren't very verbal, and now people are used to me and I'm better at my job as well, to be fair. So it's a safer place than it used to be for me, but it's not always the most helpful place. So yeah, I think it's more about being present in person. I stream on Twitch when I'm home from events. I'll do a couple of hours a day because I've got to get a lot of stuff done around my stream. I'm not a full-time streamer, but it's really nice because it means I'm playing Counter-Strike or sometimes other games as well. And I'm hanging out with the community there as well. And that's a much more accessible way. And, you know, I'm not broadcast me, although I'm similar on broadcast to how I am in real life. I don't like put anything on. It's just that I don't swear when I'm on broadcast, whereas I do when I'm playing Counter-Strike on my stream. Like, I can't help myself.
Yeah, I know. When you're playing a game, you just get into it, don't you? And you're just kind of like, sorry. That happened.
Yeah, and I've been streaming longer than I've been hosting as well. So I have some people who've been subscribing to my stream for over probably 2 years now, and then I have people who literally come into my chat and go, I didn't know you streamed, I know you from esports. I'm like, well, welcome, come along,
come enjoy. Join
yeah,
join my fray.
Yes, don't be shocked by the mark, I swear.
It's okay, we all do it. I mean, granted, I have to sort of edit myself now and say fudge and sugar, but it, realistically, you know that I mean those words. So with esports in mind, it's become like crazy big now. I mean, even my grandparents are coming to me and are just kind of like, Lauren, did you know that this person made this much money off of this mm-hmm. esports thing? And I'm just like, yeah, you have come into my world now. This is a bit scary. As a result, like, there are always just huge productions now, but the primary broadcast talent can vary quite a lot from event to event. So how much notice do you generally get before events take place that you've been cast?
Oh, it really varies. Like, I know, and in fact, it's been announced that I'm doing the PC gaming show, which isn't esports, but it's something I've done at E3 for the past 2 years. So that's been announced. I've got something booked for September, something booked for August, and a few other things as well. So I think what's happening is partly the industry's changing and they're trying to book us sooner mm-hmm. than they used to, because sometimes it could be like less than a month before. I've Jeez. Been booked for stuff 5 days before or
wow.
less, especially when I first started out, because I was, you know, I was wasn't first choice, understandably, because I just started out, so I was covering for people really, or like an emergency last minute host, and so that worked in my favor, and I definitely don't mind that. But now I'm further along, I need advanced bookings because I need to get my calendar in order, and I need to have sometimes a holiday, and I didn't last year apart from Glastonbury, I think. Oh, and I went for 3 days, I went to Portugal over a weekend, but I basically didn't really have much in terms of holiday, just because even though I wasn't always on events towards the end of the year, I was doing stuff between them, and I have sponsors and obligations, and I'm now definitely getting my calendar in order, so I pretty much got stuff until September and then on the other side of September it's a bit clearer, but it can
It'll
get
fill
a bit
up again.
Intense. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, it tends to be now for me a few months before.
I guess that must be really important. Is it a bit weird to be working like that, like coming from, you know, sort of working a normal, quote unquote, normal job to like sort of booking sort of random chunks of time for events? I mean, they're not random really anymore because these things happen yearly, but like just having these chunks of time instead of like, I'm going to be at work from Monday to Friday every week and I have holidays here, here and there.
There was definitely a period after Christmas where I was going, oh, it'd be nice to have that. But I really like the lifestyle I have now. It is, it's more ad hoc, and the days when I'm on production are really long. And then when I'm at home, I'm just trying to get my butt into gear and make sure I research, because I'm doing some new games this year. I've really done one new game in Call of Duty, and it's a lot of research. It's a lot of work, especially when it's a new game. So I definitely wouldn't change that. But what happened this year or last year, and it happened the year before, is around Christmas time, it can get quite mentally quite hard, because you're going, I'm never going to work again. Or I both years I had to turn down a league because of different reasons, but I then was going into the new year going, oh, I'm gonna never work again, and actually it's fine. But you know, it's always touch and go for a bit. Counter-Strike's going into a lot of leagues, for example, and I knew I wasn't doing two of them, and so it's really tough. I mean, there's a third, and I wasn't involved with that last year, so it's not necessary that I'll be involved with that this year either. But I do a lot of big events as well, so I know that I should be doing some of those, so it can be a bit difficult to kind of tell yourself that.
Yeah, you have to like motivate yourself.
Yeah, exactly. And I didn't get asked to do Blast, which was a series I did every single one of their events last year, and that was a hard thing, because I didn't get told why they didn't want me for it.
Oh, that's hard.
So that was definitely a hard thing mentally, because I thought, I wasn't sure with that one, but When I look at that show, it's a really, really good lineup, and the lineup makes sense. So I sort of came up with the phrase for myself last year. I'm sure other people have already come up with it. I'm not like a genius originating anything, but I realize that it's okay to be happy for your friends that are working, but you're still allowed to have a little bit of heartbreak for yourself that you're not. Like, you're allowed to feel both emotions, because there is conflict in this industry. You know, you're friends with your competitors and you want to see them do well, but at the same time, you want to be there too. And there's not always space for both of you.
Yeah. And like, I mean, I come from acting. So like the thought of rejection, like the dealing with rejection is just, it's exactly that. You have to give yourself time to grieve just as much as you have to give like your friends props as well, to just be like, you know, keep them in front of mind and stuff. And who knows, maybe they can help you with something in the future as well.
Yeah, for sure.
And then you have the privilege of working and being a part of like various broadcast teams in many different countries. You've worked with many different companies. So how do you adapt to the differing expectations, especially when you aren't even always covering the same game?
I think it's a case of production telling me what they want. I think something we can get better at as a whole in esports is feedback and just working out how the tone should differ between events and things like that. Because if someone doesn't have a conversation with me about what they're looking for, then I don't know necessarily what they want me to deliver. Obviously, interviews, yeah, but what exactly do you want in terms of focus for those interviews? So there's a difference, for example, between stage and sideline. Sideline's going to be a lot more focused on the details of the game that just happened. And then on stage, it's much more about the overarching storyline, because gameplay, those details don't necessarily work when you've got an audience yelling. So I know that I had a bit of criticism on Reddit about Call of Duty League, because I wasn't going to go hard on game details, but part of that, apart from me being new to the game and not wanting to kind of overstep and mess something up, was that I was on stage and literally the audience in London is amazing, but they're very raucous and they'll be shouting like wanker, wanker during an interview.
Oh my God.
And it's like, how I can't talk to you about your rotations or a you know, spawn trapping when literally people are shouting go back to Halo.
Yeah,
you know, it's a stage interview. You have to work with the crowd there.
Yeah.
So yeah, I have had fantastic, like more hands-on approach from TOs like ESL. So Sean Clark, who's a product manager, who his casting name is Apollo, very, very well known for his work in StarCraft, and Carmack, who is like the VP of esports or something like that for ESL. Basically, he's a big deal, and he oversees all their big events, and he's really great at giving me feedback and giving me an idea of what he wants. So when it gears up to the playoffs, when you're in the arena as opposed to the group stage, that's when starts to get a bit more serious in tone with the questions and the delivery and things like that. So yeah, group stage day one, no one's going home, so maybe you are a little bit lighter in your approach. But then once you get to the arena and the prestige and what that trophy means to people, that's when your clothes get more serious and so does your tone.
I mean, like you said about the sort of like negativity, I deal with it a bit on YouTube. I cover Final Fantasy, and I basically feel sometimes that I have to be even more of an expert about the game. Otherwise, like I, as you say, like I risk like people sort of yelling at me in comments. It must be like so much harder with people shouting at you in like real life. How do you sort of deal with the negativity? Do you just kind of like sound it out?
Well, no one shouts at me in real life, luckily.
I mean like the wanker stuff, like it's just like, like that,
well,
like that type of thing.
Shouting at us. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry, I missed that.
It's okay. No, don't worry. No, I mean there was some shouting at the CDL players. So some people were like, she didn't protect them. But then I remember when I first did exit interviews and people were like, oh, she was so patronizing because I was being too protective of the player. So now, like, while I want the player to be comfortable, it's not my... And I actually did chastise the audience a bit in that situation. But, like, it depends on what the game is. It's... While I do... When I'm on stage, you know, I'm in charge and I need to make sure that that runs smoothly, right? I have the control. So I never want a player to feel terrible about a situation, but and it can be perceived differently to the audience watching at home to the audience that's there.
Yeah.
But yeah, in terms of comments and things like that, I also know that once I've been in a scene for a while, then I'm going to get better at my job and the audience is going to get used to me, like I said earlier. So I care way more about what my peers think and what production thinks, because they're the ones who hire me, than what the audience thinks. Of course, if the audience like me, then that's great, because I'm more likely to get hired in a way, because they're the ones who watch at the end of the day. So they do mean a lot to me, and I am one of them at the end of the day as well. But yeah, it definitely was a process last year of getting used to it, but now I'm kind of okay with stuff. Like if I see comments, it depends on the context, but they don't tend to knock me back really.
So I noticed that the past few years you've been an interviewer, you've been a reporter, desk host and stage host. There's bound to be like similarities between these roles, but how do you prepare for sort of each of them?
I prepare for each of them like before the event in the same way, which is that I'm looking, for example, I'll use Counter-Strike as an example because I use HRTV as a resource, which is a website which has all the team details, stats, match history and things like that. So I'll be looking at their map pool based on their last few matches. I might look at, if it's a new team I don't know before, I might look at what weapons they particularly use individually and their average rating on the server. So for example, if I don't know a team, which team is the AWPer, aka the sniper player, I really want to find that out. So I look at those kinds of things. I look at their results. I look at which players played with each other before across different teams as well, because there might be some storylines there. So to be honest, in terms of that, I'm preparing the same way. But when it comes to actually being at the event and the interviews I'm prepping, if it's for the stage, then yeah, I'm looking way more about narratives across that team's history and the tournament, as opposed to, and I'm watching the game very closely just in case there's any moments. But when I'm doing a sideline interview, I need to watch the game really, really closely, try and keep my eye on stats as it goes, which is why HRTV is an amazing platform, because literally I have the stats as they happen. Whereas with other games, that might not be the case. Working on the LEC League of Legends for 1 week was really eye-opening, actually, because they have a stats team there and you can just jump on a little comms device in the green room and just ask for the stats team and ask for some information and they'll get back to you within 2 minutes. It's absolutely incredible to work with. That's just amazing. You can also request to have certain clips up on screen and things like that as well. So that was a really cool experience. So yeah, trying to work with production to just get that information and deliver it on screen is really important. But yeah, I'd say I'd prepare for them in the same way, but mentally, I guess, is slightly different. I'm a bit out of practice with desk hosting. I want to do more of it because I sort of started out in that zone. Because with the desk, you are much more reliant on your run of show and the details within it. You need a producer that actually cuts anything you don't need and really works with you, and you're going to have a lot more going on in your ear than when you're doing interviews or stage for the most part. So there's more of a direct relationship with the producer that you need to have, because if they're going to, you need someone who's not going to monologue in your ear. You might have a shorthand for when you're going to go to the break or when they're going to bring something up on screen, and you need to be very clear about what that dialogue is going to sound like in your ear before you start.
Yeah, I mean, that must be so like stressful to just have like all of that going on around you, like at least with an interview. I mean, granted, you have to still be aware of what's going on, but to be a desk host, to have everything else sort of work around you, that must have a lot of electricity.
Yeah, you've got an analyst with you. You're rarely on your own with a desk. So in some ways it's my favorite role because you're not on your own. With the stage, you've got a whole audience with you, but it's, for me, it's actually technically the most demanding role, which sounds weird because actually there's more elements to desk hosting, but for me stage hosting is way harder because you don't have an auto cue, you can't throw to someone else, you just need to get out there and hit the points you want to make. And I hate having cards on stage, but I often take them as a security blanket even though I won't look at them on screen. So it's like having to trust yourself, having to trust that the producer is going to know when to tell you to wrap, but also if they notice you've forgotten something or there's a detail or something like that, you know, you just need that reassurance there, because we don't really use auto cues in esports. They do have them sometimes on the desk, but I've never used one on stage. And actually, I think the auto cue is really, really important to have on stage if there's a specific script they want you to hit. If not, that's fine. Give me some bullet points in advance so I can try and write something in my brain about it in advance. But don't hand me a script on the day and be like, we want you to deliver this. Because unless I can read it off a card, like if it's an announcement, that's fine. But if it's like the whole show and it's a script, then having to suddenly pick that up on the day is kind of brutal.
Yeah, especially because you also have to like kind of play off of the other person as well.
Well, yeah, you haven't got a person to play off. That's the problem with on stage.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's hard, but it's also really fun. Like I shied away from stage hosting and I've started to get back into it. And now I really, really enjoy it. I just love that stuff with the audience. What I would love is I often ask to do a warm up with the audience before we go live on the broadcast because I want to test the waters, see how they're going to react and all that kind of stuff. But I wish I could sort of do a bit more of that stuff on the broadcast itself, like actually do more with the audience. Like I used to work in comedy and I'm like by no means a stand-up comedian, but the presence I have or the way I use the stage is probably quite similar to how some of my friends who are comedians use it, if that makes sense.
Absolutely.
So it's not super formal. It's quite, you know, I'm gonna kind of roam that stage a bit and I'm gonna, you know, I want to be able to chat to the audience and bring them in and stuff like that.
Yeah. And unlike other sports industries where a lot of the interviewees are media trained, when you do interviews, have you found it challenging to interview people on such a large scale that perhaps aren't quite used to the media spotlight, we'll say?
Yeah, sometimes you get people who are a bit nervous. I need to simplify my questions for people where English isn't their first language. I will grab people before I interview them so I can just see how their personality's like, so I get an idea of what they're going to be like with me. And I also just want to kind of reassure them that like when I'm interviewing someone, like I'm not trying to catch them out or anything like that, but I mean, I guess if they're not giving me what I'm looking for, like giving me the answers to my questions and they maybe put up a front or something, then I'll push them a bit harder than they were not doing that because it's my job to get to get those answers. So yeah, I will have a little bit of fun with that. If they're gonna put a wall up, then I'll get a sledgehammer. But
yeah,
for the most part, it's usually just when players have stock answers, oh, we played our own game, etc., etc., and it's like, oh, okay,
yeah,
oh, that's given nothing for the desk to talk about. So talk to me about what your own game was there. Like,
it's a bit like when I used to go to E3 and they would just sort of read off the press release and you're just kind of like, oh, for frick's sake, please.
Yeah,
just give me a little bit more.
Yeah, exactly.
And you've gone from strength to strength over the past couple of years, even winning the best presenter at the UK Esports Awards 2 years in a row. Given your wealth of experience, what do you think is the best way to get started and noticed for those who are thinking about esports broadcasting as a potential career?
I think you have to put yourself out there. So when I first started doing online production, I was blogging and I was making videos and I was doing everything I can to create and putting it on my own platform. So I think what you need to do is you have to create your own platform and put stuff there. And then once you've got a body of work, you then have evidence. You can send it to people. So with the hosting stuff, I've been a producer for years. So I had that foundation and I had contacts that I had through when I was a producer at Twitch, but I didn't use them for hosting when I was there. I didn't want to kind of muddy those waters. But then as soon as my job was closed, I emailed those contacts and I had a show reel because I started doing a weekly show on a channel called Jinx. And the reason they got me was because they knew who I was. I think quite a few people in the UK industry, gaming industry, knew who I was because of, or at least in sort of the PR-y, publishy marketing side, because of me putting them on stage at events like EGX and Gamescom and things like that.
Sure.
But I did an interview with them about the Twitch stage at Gamescom in 2017. And then because they like my personality, they decided to put me on this show called The Bridge, which had started a year earlier and had kind of shaped itself. I'd been kind of reshaped and things like that over the past year. But I was the last kind of co-host on that. And I hosted a few episodes as well. And that gave me material. And ESL UK did a couple of things with me as well. And sometimes I filled in for hosts on stage when I didn't have budget for enough hosts for 8 to 10 hour shift. So occasionally I might pop up on stage for like 15 minutes or 20 minutes. So yeah, I had something to show. And I think that's basically the takeaway, is have something to show. If you want to be doing something, do it. Yes, you're not going to get paid necessarily from doing it on your own platforms. Maybe you'll build up a following and eventually you will. But you need to get the practice and you need to work out what you want to do and then just do it. And then eventually, if you're good enough, then you'll be doing it on the big stage and you'll get paid to do it.
Absolutely. All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. And it was so great to talk to you.
Ah, thank you for having me.
That's it for this episode of She Plays Games. If you'd like to learn more about Frankie, you can follow her on Twitter at GetFrank. Also, if you want more episodes of She Plays Games, please be sure to subscribe and follow me on iTunes, Spotify, and YouTube by searching She Plays Games, and on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at She Plays Podcast. If you want to be on the show or want to nominate someone to come on the show, you can email me at SheplaysPodcast@gmail.com. See you all next time on She Plays Games.